Good evening, everyone. I'm very pleased to be here, and I would like to put out my thanks to Autumn, Nikki, and Willow, who made this panel and the events around the exhibit and the exhibit itself possible, and also thanks to the museum. At the last panel that we did, I did not have the opportunity to see the slideshows of my panelists from my vantage point. So it was reminded me that Raoul Hilberg also plays a very significant role in a movie I'll talk about in my presentation called Show-Off by Claude Lanzmann. He spends a lot of time interviewing him, as well as the Holocaust Museum Los Angeles. I do a lot of research around Holocaust museums. Also has a very extensive exhibit on newspapers and the idea of the newspaper stories being built, being buried very deeply inside. So I approach my work as a rhetorician. So I do writing and rhetoric. And I like to think about memory, but not just individual memory. I focus on the phenomena of public memory, the ways in which we share memories as a culture, and the ways in which we choose to memorialize, right? So they are all conscious, intentional acts, the way we choose to memorialize as different cultures. I focus a lot on the United States, though I have done some work on European locations, for example, Berlin, Germany. In public memory, especially around traumatic history, there is a tension between both remembering but also forgetting. I spent years studying the Holocaust, talking to people, talking to survivors, visiting sites and museums, and it seems that we should know what happened, yet so many do not. Recent polls have found shocking statistics. According to the Anti-Defamation League, 41% of Americans and 66% of millennials couldn't say what Auschwitz was. One of the most disturbing statistics is perhaps that, quote, the survey also found 22% of millennials said they had never even heard of the Holocaust or really weren't sure. In 2017, major anti-Semitic incidents were reported in every single state in the United States. And 2020 ranked as the third highest year for anti-Semitic incidents against American Jews since the Anti-Defamation League started tracking the data in 1979. Public acts of hatred just in the last few months, and even just today in the newspaper, include the synagogue hostage situation in Texas and the anti-Semitic flyers distributed in Miami, Houston, and Virginia. We know there is a correlation between education and tolerance, however. A study in Hungary showed that the less young people knew about Judaism and the Holocaust, the more likely they were to hold anti-Semitic views. The importance of continuing education is revealed in these correlations. Public memory is based in part on our facts about the Holocaust that reside in the public's collective knowledge base. These artifacts are rhetorical because they allow for interpretation, because they come from various perspectives and contexts. Although public memory will always be constructed in this way, it's not a one-way street. It becomes relational as we connect our present to their past. But it is also crucial that education stay dynamic and create dialogue, much as the panel we are doing today. I'm going to share just a few examples of how public memory around the Holocaust in America creates these spaces for dialogue. Now, one way they do that is they juxtapose old and new. And by this, I mean old and new information, right? So original historical facts, and then as historians study more and discover more in archives, for example, you add more facts to that. And there are also things that I enjoy looking at in my work that have to do with new forms, new formats, new ways of expression, new art. So the way that we can think about public memory in these newer ways is to think about how we can emotionally connect to the facts of history. And really, we need these connections very badly right now. Education and dialogue are one way to achieve it. Yet, the idea of inclusive education in America has always been fraught. discussions of what to teach in terms of inclusivity are at a fever pitch in this country right now. Many American textbooks whitewash histories of discrimination, and the politicization of education of late is particularly disturbing. So I'm going to move ahead to one slide. I have a couple of one slide out of order. One example is the Texas House Bill 3979, passed last year, which bans discussions, well, any discussions, of gender or racial discrimination. And this was opposed by no less than 97 educational organizations. Soon after, a district superintendent in North Texas had to apologize after telling teachers, quote, "If you have books about the Holocaust in their classroom libraries, then they should also include books that have, quote, opposing views of the Holocaust," end quote. As one teacher noted, "How do you present books that oppose the Holocaust, which is a documented historical event? Do you present Holocaust denial as legitimate?" Book bans have also been a feature of the American landscape for decades, but the recent rise in the last year is a little chilling. One recent call was to ban Art Spiegelman's Mouse from public school libraries in Tennessee for nudity, among other reasons. As you can see from this slide, there's a page from the book, and that shows you how he drew it and how he's depicting the story. Clearly, this misses the point of the content and context of this text as Holocaust history. Independent bookstores ended up sending or delivering free copies of Mouse to anyone in Tennessee who wanted one. And LeVar Burton's recent viral video called kids to read banned books just like this one. These can be moments of hope. I also wanted to let you know that today's George Ann also covered the story of the banning of the Mouse text today. This kind of support for broad inclusive education is important. So Holocaust museums, where I do a lot of my research, are a good example of impactful memory work, and they have always held the education of the public as one of their primary missions. Over the years, with the rise of anti-Semitism and the resistance to teaching comprehensive histories of hate and discrimination, Holocaust-focused museums have expanded their purview to cover other genocides, hate crimes, and discrimination in general. So for example, I mentioned the Los Angeles Museum. The Florida Museum in St. Petersburg has a very extensive exhibit on segregation, civil rights movement, and the things that were happening in Florida during that period as well. So last year, for example, in St. Louis, the Holocaust Museum began a project to quadruple in size and, quote, "dive deeper into social justice, human rights, and racism," end quote. Steven Spielberg is partnering with a new museum, and he's been involved for a long time since he mentioned the list, with the museum in Orlando to make his over 52,000 oral histories available to the public. The community and online spaces created by Holocaust museums, therefore, have an important role in mitigating hate speech and discriminatory behavior, especially online. Their online presence and expanding partnerships in communities create more access points to educational material that is fully vetted, and it broadens their public reach through greater accessibility. In addition to museums, audiences in America have typically been directed toward memory artifacts that memorialize from a now somewhat familiar perspective. So I want you to think about name recognitions of people like Anne Frank, Elie Wiesel, who are taught in public schools, and also the U.S. Holocaust Museum in D.C. But what is happening now around, continues to happen around public memory and the Holocaust, is that the centering on visual culture from a range of perspectives. And Lawrence Langer, who is a very esteemed scholar of Holocaust studies, says, quote, "As the event recedes in time, it grows more and more difficult to recapture the way it was for those who faced it. Everything has come to depend on who tells the tale and how," end quote. So neither history nor memory is static. The facts remain, but we learn more with time. So this is why it is important to keep remembering. So I'm going to move to my first artifact here. Claude Lanzmann is a French director, and he created a film that came out in 1985, but he spent over 10 years gathering these interviews and doing these site visits to create this, this film. It was a landmark 9-hour documentary, and it told the story of the Holocaust in first-hand testimonies, which had never been done before, and also on-site footage of the death camps, which were actually deserted, right? So there was a lot of bombed-out buildings and sometimes nothing except grass. So it revealed a lot that we didn't know. But with the passing of the 20th century into the 21st, we have discovered that there are interview outtakes for this film. And the film ended up leaving out a lot because it had over 350 hours of interview footage. Lanzmann chose to use less than 20 minutes of women's testimony, for example, though he had hours and hours more. So in this image, I show you Ruth Elliott. And her her videos are accessible at the museum on the website. So she's one survivor who talks about the particularly gendered torture that she experienced in the camps around childbirth and medical experiments. And it is really not a story that we have heard before. And I definitely recommend that you go see it, but it is very, very difficult to watch. And that's not why I'm not describing it. So these kinds of stories are really important to present-day remembrance because they allow public memory to become broader and more inclusive of all these multiple perspectives that we haven't yet heard. They can speak in and beyond the film itself, as I said, by being available at the Holocaust Museum website to anyone who is interested. Historical stories can also be told from new perspectives in newer forms, as I said, that I'm interested in looking at. And they often extend to younger generations in ways that, in which they might make meaning differently, right? So younger generations are farther away from events, right? And they engage with different mediums than before. So there's this beautiful film called Numbered from Israel. And the stories of the survivors are told intergenerationally. So they interview the survivors, but also their children and their grandchildren and things like that. And they also use the concentration camp tattoo as the connecting image throughout the film. While this tattoo was forced upon prisoners in the camps, some third and fourth generation survivors had willingly chosen to tattoo themselves with their grandparents' camp tattoo as a form of remembrance and as a mark of pride and resilience. Here we see Abramo and Eyal, grandfather and grandson, lovingly holding each other's tattooed arms. My last image is from the cover of Mouse. So if you're not familiar with it, that's the cover. It comes in two parts. So historical stories can also be told in newer forms that like comic books, right? And when this book came out, it was actually rather controversial because of the way it was drawn. And Art Spiegelman is a comics creator, so he wanted to write in the medium that he was most comfortable with, but then also tell this real historical story of his father. And this book has really, literally, reached millions and millions of people and won the Pulitzer Prize for literature. And it really speaks to adults and children in very different ways. I teach all of the forms that I have shared with you and many more in my classes, and I always find that students are very engaged with these newer forms, and they are very surprised by them, so that they are thinking that they knew a lot, some things, maybe a lot of things, maybe nothing about the Holocaust, but then when they came in contact with these forms, they had this engagement and curiosity to learn more. And I think that that's one of the most important things we can use education for, is to create that curiosity and that desire to learn more. So in closing, America is really experiencing a lot of strife and division at the moment. And I often ask myself, is there a way to come together when we seem so very divided? And I think that it's really important that people are willing to constantly revisit this history and think it through and talk about it. The first-hand witnesses, their families, the next generations of audiences and artists, confronting knowledge about the Holocaust and what it means to the new context of our present, right? So I think that this is hopeful, but some audiences may also ask, does it really matter? Hate persists despite all this work. For me, it not only matters, it matters more in light of such events. Because we know that when intolerant views become public and are multiplied, they become normalized. And intolerance thrives with the us versus them construction. Binaries of language or emotion or representations don't really depict our complicated world, and they really never have, but they persist because they are simple, even if they are inaccurate. So thinking that Hitler was evil and the reason for the Holocaust is simple, though researchers have proved that false, but it persists because it's easier to dismiss that as an anomaly in humankind. So disturbing this collective normalization process with dialogue, I like to call the performance of memory, which means that it is an invitation to participate, an invitation to intervene and turn toward others instead of away from them. And it's an opportunity to honor the memory of those who were lost and spread hope for generations that follow to make the world as much of a better place as we can. Thank you.